Unrestrained. That's what we're seeing today. We are prosperous. We have plenty. We have more than plenty. You go to the grocery store, the shelves are always full, unlike many other countries where the shelves are very sparse. The shelves are always full here. But we're living unrestrained lives. People are doing what is right in their own eyes, not what God has said.
Good morning. We want to welcome you to our Sunday morning broadcast. Pastors David and Donna Spearman welcome you. Welcome to Kingdom First, located here in Fort Wayne. As we say, God loves Fort Wayne.
Jubilee, thank you, Lord, for bringing us here safely, for putting breath in our bodies this morning, for allowing us to come here and to worship you.
Why I sing.
God will use you. It doesn't matter what your station in life is. You know, we turn on, flip on a TV and watch TBN or whatever, you know, your favorite Christian television network is, and we see all these preachers and so forth. And I mean, you know, they're sons and sons and sons and sons of pastors and preachers, and you know, some of their lineage goes back, you know, 200 years of pastors and preachers in the family and all that. And here you are, you know, like me. You know, there was not a preacher in the family. And God plucked me out of nowhere and said, I'm going to use you. And he'll do the same with you. He'll use you if you let him. He'll use you to do great things if you let him. You know, a lot of times the things we go through in life, the things we suffer, the things we face, the stuff we have to claw and fight to get past and all that, a lot of times we look at that as, man, you know, such bad luck. I'm having such bad luck. Well, there's no such thing as bad luck. You know, things come at you. How you handle them determines your character. All right? Determines your character. So when things come at you, how are you going to look at it? Are you going to look at it like, oh man, it's such bad luck? Or are you going to look at it and say, hey, you know something? Whatever this may be, wherever it's coming from, I know God's going to turn it around for me and bring it to my good. And he's going to use that, he's going to use that experience in my life to bring glory and honor to him. And sometimes those experiences are really rough and tough. Sometimes they're horrendous. Sometimes you feel like you're in a holding pattern. You feel like, wait a minute, Lord, you know, you said 20 years ago, you gave me a word that you're going to do a certain thing in my life. And now it's been 20 years and that has not happened. And you feel like you're in a holding pattern. You feel like you've been maybe set aside, and others who are behind you, God is pushing forward and you haven't been pushed forward. That happens. But we have to understand something. God's timing is perfect. It's always perfect. And God has a way of bringing you forth at the right time, just when he needs you. Y'all hear what I'm saying? So you cannot ever get discouraged. You cannot allow yourself to, you can't allow the enemy to get you to thinking that God has forgotten about you. He has not forgotten about you. You are special to him. Remember, we are his special people. That's what the Bible says over in Peter. We are his special, a holy nation, chosen people. So because of that, you need to understand God has not forgotten about you. Instead, God is holding you in reserve. That one of the things I like that God said to Elijah when Elijah had run from Jezebel. He took off because Jezebel said she was going to kill him. And so Elijah took off. He took off, man. He was gone. And I'm getting out of Dodge. I'm not going to let this woman kill me. And so he took off, and there he was now praying and complaining to God, as a lot of us do sometimes, complaining to God, you know, oh, I'm the only one left. There's nobody serving you but me. I'm it. I'm the only. Now he had just got done, showing up all these prophets, 450 prophets of Baal and prophets of Ashtoreth. They, killed all these prophets, showed them up, and in fact, they had no power, but the power behind him was the power of God, and all that, this great and wonderful miracle, and now he's lamenting, and that's what happens sometimes. Let me share this with you, because you're going to have this great and wonderful thing happen where God is moving on your behalf, man, and doing some great stuff in your life. God has used you in a mighty way, and then all of a sudden, when that happens and you're like, wow, yeah, go, Lord. Yeah, that was awesome. Thank you. Thank you for using me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And the next moment somebody says something about killing you and boom, off you're running. And now you're over there crying. Oh, God, there's nobody left but me. Our emotional swing is from great joy in what God has done to now is look at poor little old me. Wait a minute. Poor little old you. God just used you in a mighty way. God did some great things through you to impress the world, and now you're over here crying. And it always tickles me because here he is, and it's human. It's just like us. That's how we operate. And he's crying over there, talking about, "Oh, I'm the only one, Lord. Everybody's abandoned you. Everybody's abandoned you. I'm the only one." Now the people had just got saying, "God is God." They just got through saying that, God is God. But now he's complaining, I'm the only one. But that's when you're having a pity party, that's how you look at things. And God had to remind him, no, you're not the only one. I've got 7,000 who have not bowed their knee to Baal or kissed his hand or kissed his ring. I've got 7,000 who are not worshiping me. I've got 7,000 in reserve. I've got some people. And you got to understand, sometimes you might be the one that God has got in reserve. Huh? You might be part of that reserve that God has got. You haven't bowed your knee to Baal. You haven't given in to the culture. You haven't given in to things. But yet it doesn't seem like you're going anywhere. But you got to realize God is about to use you and he's going to take you somewhere. He's going to take his reserve and bring them forward. See, the reason you have reserves is so that... When things get going, you can bring them up to reinforce and to help in the fight. God has still got you. God is still using you. God is still going to do some things with you. You're just in reserve. See, that's like Amos. He was in reserve. He was a guy who was a shepherd and a dresser of sycamore trees. But he was in reserve, see? But then came a point in time in his life when God said, Amos, you're up to bat. Amos, it's your time. Amos, get out there. I'm going to give you a message, and that message you're going to give to Israel to let them know that I'm about to drop the hammer. You're the guy that's going to give them that message. Yeah, I got Hosea over here, but I'm not giving him that message. I got a different message for him. I got you for this message. I'm giving you this message. And so God will bring up the reserve. Amen? See, it's just like Gideon. Gideon, man, he was in reserve. You know, when the angel of the Lord saw Gideon, where was he at? He was hiding out. He was hiding out from the enemy. And most of us say he was a coward. But the angel of the Lord looked and said, "Hail, you mighty man of valor." Because he didn't see him the way what he was doing there. He saw his potential. He saw what God was about to do with him. He saw what God was about to take him. Amen. He saw how God was going to use him to defeat the very enemy that he was cowering from. He saw what God was going to do. He called him a mighty man of valor. So you may look at yourself in the mirror and say, "Oh man, I'm not worth any of that. Lord, you know, I don't even know why you put up with me." But see, God will look at you and say, "Mighty woman, mighty man of valor, mighty man of God." Because he sees what he's about to do with you. He sees how he's about to use you. And you've got to allow God to use you in those arenas. Amen. You've got to quit having a pity party, and you've got to be able to step back and realize, "I'm just in reserve for right now, but my day is coming. I may have gone through some things, but those things I've gone through, those horrendous things I've gone through, are just preparing me for when God calls my name and says, 'You're up.' And when it's time for me to be up, I got to be ready. I've got to be ready. I got to be prayed up. I've got to be ready. My faith has got to be strong. I've got to be ready. I'm in reserve right now. But one day, that day comes when God says, 'Your turn.' I got to be ready." Amen. Are you ready for when God says it's your turn? See, Amos was a man who was ready when God said it was his turn. He was ready. Here he was, a shepherd, or nothing but a farmer, and yet he was ready. When God says, "You're up, Amos," Amos was like, "Okay, Lord, let's go. What do you need me to do? I'm ready to say." You won't read in that book any place where Amos, was like, "Oh, I'm not a prophet." You won't read him saying, "I'm not a priest." You won't read about him giving God any complaint. All you read about is Amos receiving what God said and then going out and saying it. See, he was one who was in reserve. God has a whole bunch of folk like that. That's where he told Elijah, "I got 7,000 in reserve. I got 7,000 who haven't bowed their knee to Baal. I've got 7,000 at any moment. I can call any one of them, and they're ready to step up." Are you ready to step up when God calls you? When Amos was alive, the kingdom of Israel was split in two. We had the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom was called Israel, 10 tribes. The southern kingdom was Judah, the kingdom of Judah, two tribes, Judah and Benjamin. The other 10 were in Israel. Now, the judgment was going to come on Judah too, for there were reasons for that. But the main judgment was coming up on Israel. Now, Israel was a lot like we are. And the reason I chose to bring Amos forward and show you this is because when I read it, and I looked at it, I realized that here we are, Israel was just like modern day America, just like the modern day Western culture. They were rich. They were prosperous. They had just come from having King Solomon, who's the richest king ever, and brought such prosperity. Listen, he brought such prosperity to Israel that silver was like stones on the road. It was just that common. There was such wealth that silver was like stones on the road. That's what the Bible says. And so here they are now under the second king, one of his sons. There was two kings. One was Rehoboam, and the other was Jeroboam. One was in the north, one was in the south. And so here we find that wealth and that prosperity continues. It continues. So here you have the book of Amos and this country right now. A lot of similarities. A lot of similarities. They were experiencing this unprecedented prosperity. Listen, we in the U.S. are some of the richest people in the world. Even our poor are rich compared to over 50% of the people in the world. I think the poverty line in America right now for a family of four is $24,000, $25,000 a year. There are places in the world where they wish they had $24,000, $25,000 a year. You don't even have to go far except to our southern border, where they're paying $5 an hour, $5 an hour to auto workers, and here auto workers are on strike and want $30 or $40 an hour. I'm not saying, I understand inflation, I understand all those things, and there's a lot of economic issues and factors that involve with all of this stuff. But my point is, there's a generation in this country that's never known economic hard times. We've had economic prosperity for 20 plus years. I can remember when my wife and I first got married, and here we wanted to get a house and so forth. And I remember inquiring about interest rates, and it didn't even faze us that interest rates were 10% plus, because that's the way it had always been. That's what had always happened. Now we are in what I call unprecedented interest rates, because even now they've gone up a little bit, but I think we got our house at a little under 4% interest. You know, a lot of places have got their interest rates at, you know, people got their interest rates at 2.5% and so forth and so on. What does that do? You know, what's the whole point of the interest rate thing? Well, the whole point is, the lower the interest rate, the more house I can buy, the more car I can buy. You know, a higher interest rate, maybe I can only afford a $20,000 car. But with a low interest rate, I can afford a $40,000 car. With a low interest rate, I can afford a $250,000, a $300,000, a $350,000 house. With a high interest rate, all I can afford is a $100,000 house. Because most of us don't buy based on the price, we buy based on the payment. Am I right? We buy, you know, how much is that going to cost me a month? That, you know, forget what the price of the car is. What is that going to cost me a month? What do I have to come out every month out of my paycheck for this thing? And that's how we purchase stuff. You know, big items like cars and homes and so forth. That's how we do it, based on the interest rate. But we are a wealthy nation. I remember as a kid growing up when we were poor. We were poor, couldn't even afford the O and the R. All right. But we were poor. You know, we didn't have a telephone in our house until 1966. Yeah, look at you. Wow. We always had a phone in our house. We didn't have a phone. You know, if you wanted to use a telephone, you went down to the payphone. You had nice neighbors, they'd let you use their phone sometimes. And I remember I went down to Kentucky and to see my aunt and uncle years ago when I was almost 7, 8 years old. They had a phone, but they had a party line. They could not ever use their phone because there was one lady on there that was always talking. See, I'm saying that, and some of y'all don't even know what a party line is. You know what I'm saying? You know, so things were different. You know, interest rates were high. You know, most people, how many of you, as families, how many of you, and you gotta raise a hand, have two cars? Look at it. Boy, I tell you what. Church I grew up in, nobody had two cars. We didn't even have a car. I went all the way through elementary school, junior high school, we didn't have a car. My car was the bus that I caught that every day. Caught the bus to school, caught the bus home from school. If I wanted to go see a girl, I caught the bus. I'm just telling you. I'm not trying to elicit anything no more than just have you understand, we are wealthy. We are wealthy. We are a wealthy people living in a wealthy nation, and we don't give glory and honor to God for the wealth that He has blessed us with. Israel was a wealthy nation. They're wealthier than all the countries around them. They had a ton of prosperity, but this is one of the things that wealth does sometimes. It can take you away from the things of God, because you become complacent. And they began to dishonor God. They began to mistreat the poor. One of the things you read in Amos is about how they mistreat the poor to the point of taking the poor and enslaving them. They not only mistreat the poor, the disabled, they worshiped idols. Because what happens after a period of time is you begin to think you got that wealth. It was through your hard work, through your efforts, and you forget that it was God who brought the wealth to you. If they would have remembered, they would have looked back and said, wait a minute, Solomon was the one who brought this wealth, and it came through God, because God told Solomon, I am going to make you the richest man ever. I am going to bless you with tremendous wealth. Well, by blessing the king with tremendous wealth, that meant that the nation would then be wealthy. It wasn't, understand, when God said to Solomon, I'm going to bless you with wealth, he wasn't just speaking about Solomon, the individual person. He was speaking to Solomon, the king of all Israel. He was telling him that through you, everybody in this nation is going to be blessed and enjoy tremendous wealth. Wow. And so when we look at this country right now today, and we recognize its wealth, it's not just because, well, I work hard or you work hard, because, see, there's a whole lot of, here again, there's a lot of economic factors that fall into this. But God works it out and set it up so that we can have this tremendous wealth. But now what should we do once we have it? Honor God. We have to honor God. Because with tremendous blessing comes a tremendous responsibility. To whom much is given, Jesus said, much is required. The United States of America has been given much. There is much required because of what he's given us. He's given us prosperity. He's given us peace. He's blessed us on so many different fronts. People from all over the world are clamoring to get here. Clamoring to come across the border, to get into this country, clamoring to get a piece of the American dream, that American pie. They're clamoring to do that. Why is that? Why is that? They're not clamoring to get into Peru, Brazil, Guatemala, Venezuela. They're not clamoring to stay in Mexico. Why here? Because of the wealth that has been generated by God in this country. And people want to be a part of that. People want to get some of that. It's not just one or two people. You've got these folks saying, oh, it's just the 1%, or it's just these folks. Is that? No. I'm telling you, they're not just, listen, Jeff Bezos or Bill Gates or Elon Musk, it's not just them. That money spreads all the way down through to so many people. You know, we talk about the CEOs, and I'm kind of off on a tangent, I know that, but bear with me. We talk about the CEOs and all that they have, but you know something, all they have does flow. Because it's not all self-contained in them. It flows to you and it flows to me, it flows to everybody. When it came to Solomon, but then it flowed to the rest of the nation. Y'all hear what I'm saying? It flowed to the rest of the nation. It just wasn't Solomon. It was all of Israel. God said, I'm going to bless you, Solomon. But he was saying, I'm blessing all this nation because you are his king. When we have people who are righteous in front, righteous standing for God as our representatives, as our presidents, as our senators and so forth and so on, then that wealth flows freely to everybody in the nation. And we have seen unprecedented wealth. Now, we have forgotten some things. And so we face the same situation as the northern kingdom Israel faced. They had this wealth, but they had turned away from God. We have this wealth, but we have turned away from God. Like I said, we have a generation, maybe two generations, that have never known economic hard times. The last time that anything was remotely difficult economically in this country was 2008. And this is 2023. Wow. Yeah, inflation is here a little bit now. Some of the prices have went up. But you know something? We're still doing well. We're still doing well. If people are abandoning places, it's not because of the economics, it's because of crime. And they leave areas and places and cities because of the crime, not because of the economy. When people start leaving because of the economy now, then you know you got some issues and some problems. So there are some consequences that come from such a level of prosperity. One of the consequences can be, doesn't have to be, but it can be people forget where their blessings come from. You know, we just got through celebrating 9/11, it's shortened down to 9/11, but what happened is September 11th, 2001. And I remember where I was. I'm sure everybody remembers where they were. And it was a horrific issue, a horrific thing that happened. And the whole nation turned to God and said, why God, why? Churches were filled that Sunday. I remember. People were, I remember I went to the local television station, the Christian television station, and I was on the air and encouraging people that God had not forgotten us, praying for people. And there was other pastors there with me. We were praying and encouraging people, quoting scripture. God had not forgotten us. It's okay. God is still in control. And people were wondering, well, if God is in control, why did this happen and why did that happen? And how? Why did he let this happen to us? And that was people's questions on the newscast and people in the streets. Why did it happen to us? Well, here's the issue. When you begin to forget about God, when you begin to forget about where your prosperity came from, when you forget about who brought the blessing, when you forget about that, then sometimes your protection leaves. See, here's the beautiful thing about the Lord. He will protect you. He will guard you. Psalms 91 tells us that we're under the wings, under his wings. We are in his protection. We are in his protection. But there's something I have to do to remain in that protection. I honor him. I remember where my blessing comes from. I remember what God has done for me. You know, what made David such a great king? What made him such, not just a great king, a great person? What made him such a great person? He always remembered who helped him in his time of trouble. He always remembered it was God who helped me. And so whenever he was facing anything tough or going through anything, what would he do? He would encourage himself. How did he encourage himself? Oh, I can do it. No, he would encourage himself by saying, God brought me through this. God brought me through that. God brought me through that. So now he's going to bring me through this thing I'm facing to do. Isn't that what he said? When he was facing Goliath, he said, God enabled me to kill the bear. God enabled me to kill the lion. And God's going to enable me to kill this uncircumcised Philistine. So you have to see, he always remembered, no matter what, no matter how rich he got, no matter becoming king and everything else, he remembered who brought him to the dance. He remembered who brought him there, how he got there. You listen, when you get, God takes you to a place, and when you forget who brought you, there's a problem. When you forget who brought you, there's a problem. Amen. God is being removed, has been removed from our governmental lives. I'm talking about in Washington, government. I mean, there was some years ago, not too long ago, there was a judge in some state somewhere. He had the Ten Commandments up in his courtroom, and he ended up losing his judgeship because he refused to take down the Ten Commandments because they said, you got to take that down. So you can go through many governmental buildings that used to have a scripture up or the things about, you know, something about God, and now it's not up there anymore. So they're slowly and effectively erasing God out of our governmental lives, our media lives. And a lot of y'all are into media, social media and everything else. But you begin to talk about God too much. You begin to, you know, talk about God here. All of a sudden, these social media places begin to cast you aside. They'll close your accounts. So, you know, now you can talk about all kind of junk and all kind of mess. You can talk about, you can cuss, you can fuss, you can talk about all kind of, you know, all kind of sin. Thank you, sister. All kind of sin. And glorify it and say, oh, how it's wonderful and great and everything else. And oh, that's awesome. That's great. That's awesome. You can do that. Well, you begin to preach, you begin to minister, you begin to talk about the things of God. Then all of a sudden, after a while, they're like, slowly want to phase you out. Sometimes they just abruptly close your account. There's things I've said here in this pulpit, and I don't think I've said too much controversy here, but there's been a couple of times YouTube closed me out. That our educational lives erased. What was it, 1962? They said you couldn't have prayer in school. Not too long ago, a coach who would go to the 50-yard line on the football team and football game and by himself just pray. They fired him. You can't do that. Well, the Supreme Court said he could. He went back to work after 8-9 years, went back there, and the school system still put pressure on him to stop. You got to quit that. You can't be doing that. Why are you so afraid of prayer? Why are you so afraid of the name of Jesus? Why are you so afraid? Well, they want to eliminate all those things and keep the name of God out of everything. So because they don't want anybody to see that God is the one who has blessed us and kept us going all these times. We're living in a time where people are doing what the Bible says is doing what's right in their own eyes. The Bible says in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, and that word vision means no revelation, it says it right there, no revelation of God and his word. It's not just having a written down vision of, oh, this is who we are and this is what we do. No, where there's no revelation of God's word, where God is being erased and eliminated out of the public square. Where there's no vision, where there's no revelation of God and his word, the Bible says the people are unrestrained. See, it's the word of God and the revelation of God that restrains people. But when there's no vision, when there's no word of God, God is you know, put aside and put in a back closet somewhere, then the people become unrestrained. But it says, happy and blessed is he who keeps the law of God. Unrestrained. That's what we're seeing today. We are prosperous. We have plenty. We have more than plenty. You go to the grocery store, the shelves are always full, unlike many other countries where the shelves are very sparse. The shelves are always full here. But we're living unrestrained lives. People are doing what is right in their own eyes, not what God has said. The Bible says in Judges 21:25, in those days when the judges governed, there was no king in Israel. Why did it specifically say there was no king in Israel? Because it's through the king that the precedent is set. And it says every man did what was right in his own eyes. Well, we don't have kings in this country, but we have presidents. And when we have presidents that aren't good, when we have presidents that are deciding to do what they want to do and not to consult God, then people are unrestrained. Proverbs 21:2 says, every man's way is right in his own eyes. Every man's way is right in his own eyes. But the Lord weighs and examines the hearts of people and their motives. And then Proverbs 16:2 lastly says, all the ways of a man are clean and innocent in his own eyes. I'm right. They think they're right. That's what he's saying. They, in their own eyes, they think they're right. And it says, and he may see nothing wrong with his actions. Why would he see nothing wrong with his actions? Because God has been put aside. There's no reminder publicly of what God is saying. So he sees nothing wrong with his actions. But the Lord weighs and examines the motives and intents of the heart and knows the truth. There is a judgment, and there is a day of reckoning. The only problem with doing things your way is that way will conflict and hamper and cause others problems in their lives. because there's no standard. See, when you, the whole point of that is when you do things that's right in your eyes, then what happens is there's no standard. And if there's no standard and you're unrestrained, you're going to do what you feel like doing, and you don't care about other people. You don't care. So now there's a move to compel you, rather, to call people their preferred pronouns. And I can't remember where it's at, but I think it's, it might be Canada. I'm pretty sure it's Canada. If you don't do that, then that's a criminal offense. So it's come down to you're doing what's right in your own eyes. You think your actions are good, but it hampers what I think. Because when there is no standard, when there is no standard, the lights go out. So what's to be done? We realize something has to be done. We all realize that there has to be some type of standard, a rule, a principle that's used as a basis for judgment. And that's what standard means. It means a rule or principle that's used as a basis for judgment. What most countries have, and I'm going to close out because my time is running out, but let me just share a few things with you. What most countries have are constitutions, and that's what they say is their standard. And that constitution is the basis for many of those countries' laws. But different countries have different constitutions, so that's not really a standard. It may be a standard temporarily for that or for that particular country, but it's not really a worldwide standard. So if you travel to a foreign country, you need to become aware of their laws. Because you go there and you say something or do something contrary to their law that you think is okay because you're from America, then all of a sudden, you find yourself in jail. If Matt Brown was here, I'd tell you to ask Matt Brown about that. He found that out in India. These constitutions are normally man-made. That's why they're going to differ from one another. So which means there's not a universal standard for humanity. But wait, there really is. I'm going to tell you about a dream that I had, and then I'll close. I had this dream last week, I think it was. And I was in the pulpit, standing here. You were out there. It was this building, this church, these pews, everything. I rarely ever dream like that. So when I have a dream like that, I know something's up. And I had this dream. And some people came into the building, and they sat toward the back. And as I was ministering the word, now I don't even remember what I was saying. The issue was, the dream was not about it really even what I was saying at that point in time. They started shouting, rabble-rousing. They started shouting and we don't believe in your God. We don't, and all kind of crazy stuff and just going out. And it was a group of people. It looked in the dream to be about, 15, 20. And they were trying to shout me down, basically. They were trying to shout me down. Now, normally, in real life, I would have gotten quite upset, but I didn't. I came down out of the pulpit. I walked back to where they were, and I asked them ever so nicely. I was surprised in the dream how nice I was. And I said, what is the problem? Why are you shouting? Why are you trying to shout me down? He said, because you don't agree with us. I said, so I have to agree with you, and then if I say I agree with you, then you're okay. And pretty much the conversation went that way. Then I began to say, but what you're saying and what you're doing doesn't meet God's standard. And they said, what are you talking about? I said, God has a standard. I said, and you're not meeting God's standard. God has a way for you and I and everybody else on this planet to live. And it's a universal standard. I said, you're not meeting that. So then it got quiet. And the Lord gave me this, and I didn't know it. There was the truth of this until I actually looked it up. I said, how many of you guys came here? Did all you guys come here in an automobile? They said, yes. Let me ask you a question. Did all you guys come here in a car, automobile? Everybody in here came in an automobile. I think, except for that sister way back there, I think she walked. But most of us came here in an automobile. And I asked him, I said, do you know how an automobile operates? They said, well, yeah, you get in, you drive, this, that, the other. I said, but do you know that there's a standard for every car ever made? Every automobile, there's a standard. It has one standard among, you know. They said, what are you talking about? Every car has a steering wheel. I said, yeah, that's not the standard, though. That's not what I'm talking about. I said, do you realize that no matter where you are, any place in the world, you can get in a car. The key, you might have a key fob, you may have put the key in this or that. I said, that's not even a standard. The standard is, on the far right, there's a gas pedal. He said, yeah. I said, and right next to that gas pedal, on the left of the gas pedal, there's a brake pedal. He said, yeah. I said, and if you have a stick shift, then the third pedal, which is left of the brake, is the clutch. And they said, yes. I said, that standard is a standard all over the world. No matter where you go, there's going to be the gas to the right, the brake to the left of that, and then the clutch next to that. Your steering wheel might be on the left or the right, but there's going to be gas, brake, clutch. You may, now I say, and of course, you know, for those who, you know, are handicapped or whatever, they do certain things, but the standard is gas, brake, clutch. See, and that's the standard worldwide. Nobody makes a car, and nobody builds a car production that doesn't have that configuration, no matter where you go. Like, so when I woke up, I was like, that's odd. But that's the standard. That's the standard. Why is that the standard? So no matter where you go, no matter where you go in the world, you rent a car in Germany, you can drive that car because it's got a gas, brake, and if it's a stick shift, the clutch pedal. And they're in that exact configuration. Any place in Europe, any place in Asia, go to China, go to Japan, it doesn't matter where you go. Doesn't matter whether the steering wheel is on the left side of the car or the right side of the car. Gas, brake, clutch if it's a stick. That's the standard. Suppose you went someplace in the world and the gas pedal, instead of being on the right, was on the far left. Can you imagine trying to drive that car? Think about it. You don't even think about gas and brake. You don't even think, it's just something you do automatically. Everybody in the world does that. But if it was over here instead, can you imagine trying to drive a car like that? So there are universal standards. Now that's a man-made universal standard, but my point is there are standards. God gave me that one, and so I just wanted to share it with you because there has to be standards to live by. There has to be standards that we use to be able to govern. There has to be standards that we use so everybody can live a peaceable and pleasant life. Because without a standard, you can't do it. Because when people do whatever's right in their own sight, we see the chaos that can ensue. When there's no penalty for crime, what begins to happen? Gangs of people go into department stores and clean the whole place out. Whatever, doing what's right in their own eyes. There has to be a standard. We'll continue this next week, but there has to. So, and next week we'll talk about universal standards Because that's it. That the gas pedal thing is a universal standard throughout the entire world. Now, there's not too many universal standards in the entire world that's man-made, but that is one of them. I don't know, did you ever notice, did you know that when I said that about the gas pedals? You ever thought about that? I never even thought about that. But I know the Lord gave that to me because he gave it to me in a dream to say there are, even men make some type of standards in order to live your life. And God has the best standard for all humanity. Amen? Amen. All right. All right. Well, praise God. I pray this has been a blessing to you. And for those who are watching my streaming live, I pray it's been a blessing to you to help you understand that there is somebody, some standards have to be set, and God is going to set the standard. Next week, we'll also talk about standards, and we'll talk about the plumb line, because in the book of Amos, God talks about, and I believe in also Isaiah, he talks about the plumb line. The plumb line is a standard, and so we'll talk about some of that, too. And so you can read about that in Amos and also Isaiah. Just look up plumb line and read about it. Amen? All right, for those watching my streaming live, God bless you. We'll see you next week.
We are grateful you chose to join us today for Pastor Dave's teaching. If you have questions during the week or are in need of prayer, please email us at office@kingdomfirstfw.com and be sure to join us for our next broadcast. During this time, please remember to be safe, be well, and be blessed.